last until church started tomorrow. We're going to Carnegie Hall! Well, we can't begin tonight without invoking the blessing of our God, and so I'm going to call on our pastor, John Vincent, to come and lead us in a word of prayer.
Gracious God and Heavenly Father, we're so thankful. All that we have and all that we are, where it comes from your hand. You direct all things. Father, you know, we would never have even dreamed of such a blessing and privilege. From a small town in the middle of, or at the edge of Henry County, in the town of Kewanee, that you would call us to New York to sing your praises. What a great God you are. We're so thankful, we pray, Father, that tonight, as we thank these folks for their contribution and their support of us, not only through their presence here, but through financial support, through their prayers and their encouragement, we're so thankful. We just pray, Father, that you would bless this group of people, this team, this choir, this group of worshipers who are going to lift high the name of our God in that great city. We pray for safety. We pray for a safe return. We pray for a sense of joy. We look forward to hearing the reports. I pray that this is a binding experience for everyone. This will be stories that we tell until we go home. See you. Thank you, Father, for the opportunity we have. We pray that you would bless this evening. We pray that you would bless each one who is here. Thankful that the mayor is here and his wife as well. Pray that you just bless him as he enters into his new term as well. We're grateful for each one who serves in one way or another the unfolding of the majestic plan of God, the tapestry that is laid out before all human history, for all the angels to see, to inquire into and wonder at the greatness of God. We thank you, Father. Bless this evening, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
And would you please welcome to the podium our Mayor, Gary Moore, to present a special proclamation. Gary?
To be able to read this proclamation set forth by Kewanee City Council. I can't think of a group of people who deserve this more. Whereas the First Baptist Church and First Congregational Church choirs for many years have provided annual holiday concerts contributing to the quality of life in Kewanee, and whereas the choir's musical ability and professional performances have led to national recognition within religious musical circles, and whereas such recognition has led to an invitation to perform in New York at Carnegie Hall on Sunday, May 26th, in the Isaac Stern Auditorium, and whereas the choir's representation of Kewanee at Carnegie Hall provides the community with a great source of pride and serves as an inspiration to the youth of our community, and now, therefore, I, Gary Moore, Mayor of the City of Kewanee, do hereby proclaim May 18, 2019, to be Kewanee Post Carnegie Day, and encourage all who are able to support the choirs of the First Baptist Church and the First Congregational Church in the noble and worthy endeavor.
Please welcome your friend of mine, Michelle Storm.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. And thank you, Munches. This is our Carnegie Hall or Bust Patriotic Concert. And you are about to experience something wonderful. David Roberts was an Episcopal priest who served in the American Civil War the 84th Ohio, in the infantry. He wrote the lyrics to God of Our Fathers in 1876 to commemorate the 100th anniversary of the Declaration of Independence. He sent the hymn to the General Commission of the Episcopal Church anonymously. They received 75 other entries. However, he said if the commission accepted his lyrics, then he would tell them his name. Just that simple. The commission chose his lyrics, but the hymn editor wrote the music and called it the National Hymn.
Thank you.
Catherine Lee Bates, age 33, an English professor at Wellesley College, took a trip to Colorado Springs to teach summer school. Several sights inspired her along the way. The Chicago Exposition, the White City with its gleaming white buildings, the wheat fields of Kansas, the majestic view of the Great Plains from high atop Pikes Peak. She penned a poem, published 2 years later to commemorate the 4th of July. It caught the public's fancy. Now back up 11 years to 1882. A genius and gifted musician, Samuel Ward, an organist at Grace Church in Newark, New Jersey, was taking a ferry boat ride from Coney Island to New York City when the tune came to him. He asked a fellow passenger, friend of his, for his shirt cuff because he wanted to write the tune on it, didn't want to forget it. So he wrote the melody for Materna, the hymn, O Mother Dear Jerusalem. Samuel passed in 1903, and in 1910, a publisher combined the poem and the melody. Samuel Ward never met Catherine Bates or to hear America.
Oh, beautiful voice, Savior.
glorious name, Words and Music by Mary MacDonald. A gifted pianist and composer, well known to sacred music. With a career that spans over 35 years, her songs appear in every major publisher of Christian church music. More than 800 anthems, seasonal musicals, and keyboard collections. As a young girl, Mary liked to play the piano, but she didn't read music. A piano teacher noticed this and offered to teach her how to read music. Well, that was all fine and dandy. When college rolled around, her father told her that she was going to become a home economics major just like her sisters. Well, Mary testifies, her greatest desire is to give God glory for the songs that he has allowed her to compose. He alone is the true creator behind my pen. She became a music major, a marvelous personality. Right, Clyde?
Yes.
Okay, all right. And a genuine delight. Please enjoy Sing Forth His Glorious Name by Mary MacDonald.
Oh, we're good. All right, thank you.
We're doing music tonight, and all of Carnegie Hall music is going to be music of Mary MacDonald. And we've been doing Mary MacDonald for quite a while, under the mostly under the direction of Pastor Dan. And so, if there's one thing most important in our being able to make this trip to Carnegie Hall, it's the relationship that Dan and Karen Craig had with Mary MacDonald. They've been going to music conferences for many years that she has led and gotten to know her on a personal basis. Enough of a personal basis that she was willing to come here to our church last November, and I hope you were able to hear the concert that she provided. Leading us, playing the piano, just a marvelous, marvelous musician, wonderful musician. So, we want to especially thank Pastor Dan, Aaron, and that relationship that has brought this opportunity to us. And in order to kind of honor that, I guess, and make that apparent, I've asked Dan to do a couple of songs directly for us. He stood up here for many years doing this, and I've just kind of taken over in the last few months. So, Dan, would you come forward and direct a couple of songs?
The origin of the song remains a mystery. Ever wonder why it sang in Europe? In 1740, the British composer Henry Carey claimed his father composed the words and music to the tune of "God Save Great George the King." It became quite popular, and in 1745, it was performed at Drury Lane and Covent Garden in London and called "God Save the King." In 1761, titled "Whitefield's Tune," the words were adapted for use in the United States when the colonies were independent from England. George Washington was greeted as he arrived in New York City for his first inauguration in April 1789 with some homegrown words to the familiar tune of "God Save the King." Smith rewrote the lyrics for a July 4, 1831 children's service when the lyrics we know today were debuted at the Park Street Church in Boston, Massachusetts.
Thank you.
called Invisible God, published in 1867 by Walter C. Smith, based his text on the first book of Timothy, chapter 1, verse 17. Now the King Eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honored in glory forever and ever. The text focuses on the creator of the universe, the invisible God, whose visible works in nature testify to his glory and majesty. Walter C. Scott, a Presbyterian pastor from Perthshire, Scotland, published poetry and many hymns. This one remains a popular hymn today.
Carol,
chairperson of all the fundraising from almost a year ago until now. Well done. Easter musical here at the piano, and she's volunteered to do this concert. Wonderful musician. We just want to thank you.
Devoted to developing friendship and understanding through education and working together. The song's focus is peace. God made it easy to cross many boundaries. 180 teenagers formed a circle, locked arms, and sang a song of peace. These inspired young people brought the song with them. As though on wings, it began an amazing journey around the globe. Campers, churches, schools, and clubs. This song has been taped, copied, printed, recorded, and shared in all 50 states at celebrations and sung by a host of recording artists, as well as the Zulus in Africa. Let There Be Peace on Earth. It received the George Washington Honor Medal from the Freedom Foundation at Valley Forge for outstanding achievement in helping to bring about a better understanding of the American way of life. Also, the National Conference of Christian and Jews has honored the composers with the Brotherhood Awards. Enjoy, and please, let there be peace on earth.
Thank you.
haven't been mentioned yet, but they deserve a lot of recognition. That's Bruce Lang and Dean Rakula, our technician. Time, volunteered their time for the better part of the week to put in a brand new system, a brand new computer system, soundboard, microphones, and everything else. They were here every day during the week, giving up their taking vacation time or whatever to be able to do that. So once again, just give them a big hand. Okay? And I'm going to ask Michelle, you're going to leave her